Welcome back to Project Element. You have been called to be a missionary, and you are doing this. You're going out into the world. You're sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with others. And from the world, you're bringing them to the Sabbath school, where they're beginning to know how to study scripture for themselves. They want to learn more. And so God has instituted the third element, gospel workers, to feed souls. This brings us to our last element, and that is the church itself. When souls are fed, then the intent and purpose of that feeding is to join them to the body of Christ. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22 and 23 forms the foundation of what we understand to be the church. Ephesians 1, 22, 23 says, "And hath put all things under his feet," speaking of Christ, "and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all." The church, then, is the body of Christ, and it is the desire of gospel workers to prepare souls to be part of the body of Christ. This is God's plan, exactly as we've outlined it, each of these elements working together, from the world to the Sabbath school, to the gospel workers, and then into the church. This is outlined the best in Acts of the Apostles, page 164. It says, "The Lord in his wisdom has arranged that by the means of the close relationship that should be maintained by all believers, Christian shall be united to Christian and church to church. Thus, the human instrumentality will be enabled to cooperate with the divine. Every agency will be subordinate to the Holy Spirit, and all the believers will be united in an organized and well-directed effort to give to the world the glad tidings of the grace of God." So we're not all out just doing our own thing in mission work. We've all been called, and yet the Lord has brought us together into the church so that our work could be organized and well-directed. God has called you to call people out from the world to eventually bring them to the church. They may not be ready for this right away, but as we go through each of the elements, we find that the last element is the one that is the goal for all of these missionaries. In 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 9, it says, "Ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." So what happens now? Souls are called, you have been involved in this calling as a missionary, and the Lord continues to bring more and more souls. Acts chapter 2 verse 47 says that when this plan is followed, there is great success. Acts 2:47, "Praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved." And do you know what he calls those that he has invited into his church? In 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 2, it says, "Unto the church of God which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours." The Lord has put us together because he knows that we need each other. We need to be organized, we need to be well directed, but we also need the support and encouragement one of another as we go forward in our mission work. This church will not always have it easy. In Acts of the Apostles, page 12, it says, "During ages of spiritual darkness, the church of God has been as a city set on a hill. From age to age, through successive generations, the pure doctrines of heaven have been unfolding within its borders." You have been called. Your church has been called to be just such a place. So how does the Lord organize his church? Well, in Ephesians, which is sometimes called the first church manual, we find some direction on how to organize the church. Let's look at chapter 4, starting at verse 11. It says, "He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers." Now notice carefully here, he doesn't say that all have been called. There are some who have been called to this work. For which purpose? Verse 12. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. This is God's organization. This is what God has done to ensure that his plan will be successful. This is why we have these elements in this specific way. An element of bringing out, an element of instruction, an element of solidification, and finally an element of joining oneself to the body of Christ. That is, from the world, to the Sabbath school, to the gospel workers, and then to the church. Such a method will actually allow you to be very successful in your mission work. Acts of the Apostles, page 11 says, "The church is God's fortress, his city of refuge, which he holds in a revolted world." God has given a specific plan to your church. Now, not everybody is going to be able to enter into the church. In Luke chapter 13 and verse 24, it says, "Strive to enter in at the straight gate, for many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able." Souls that are unwilling to commit themselves fully to the transformation of Jesus Christ will not be able to enter into the church. But there are many who will accept this gospel. They will allow themselves to be transformed by the beauty of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the Lord is adding these to the church every day. In John chapter 10, verse 16, it says, "Other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd." Some don't know the truth, and the Lord accepts those who do not know as they are. In Acts chapter 17, verse 30, "And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent." Now the Lord is calling us to go out and give the message so that souls will repent and join themselves to the body of Christ. There is no other way of salvation. 1 Corinthians 3:11 says, "For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ." We seek and desire to bring souls out of the world right into the church, the body of Christ. 1 John 5:19, we read already in the previous part of the series that the whole world lieth in wickedness. And in Matthew 28:19-20, that we were called to go and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. This is what God has asked us to do, to go into this world and share the gospel. We should not neglect this work of adding souls to the church. In Education, page 268, it says, "Another obligation, too often lightly regarded, one that to the youth awakened to the claims of Christ needs to be made plain, is the obligation of church relationship. Very close and sacred is the relation between Christ and his church. He the bridegroom, the church the bride. He the head, and the church the body. Connection with Christ then involves connection with his church. You have been called as a missionary who will bring souls out of this world, bring them to the Sabbath school, have them be fed by gospel workers, and then join them to the body of Christ, his church. It's my wish and prayer that you will be just such a missionary, fulfilling God's special plan.